Let's get started. It's time for you to learn what is the bullwhip effect. The name itself doesn't say much, but I'll soon explain everything. The bullwhip effect, often called a whiplash effect or whipsaw effect, consists in enhancing the transfer of changes in the demand in the chain of supplies. Relatively small deviations of the demand communicated by the end customers increase as the information on the demand goes up the chain to the producer and further on to the suppliers. The information flowing through the supply chain in the form of orders, in fact, does not reflect the changes in the demand in the retail market, but it includes a number of managerial decisions regarding the inventory. The orders placed with the supplier include the elements that are needed to replenish cyclical stocks and safety stocks to the level ensuring satisfaction of future demand. And now let's talk about history. The theoretical background of the bullwhip effect was examined for the first time by Jay Forrester in the 60s in the US. In his works, he dealt with the behaviors typical for the supply chain against different consumption demands and the resulting variations. In the 90s, there was a leading company that first examined this effect in detail using the example of the diapers it produced. I think it will be easiest for me to describe and for you to understand what this effect is about if I use an example. Suppose that a company, X, producing baby diapers, has a supply chain consisting of four links. Starting from the bottom of the supply chain, it consists of six female clients, mothers buying diapers for their children, six retailers, pharmacies from A to F, two wholesalers, X and Y, producer, P. The producer sells diapers in packs of 30 pieces. We assume that all children use 120 diapers per month. The mothers buying in one pharmacy do not know the locations of other pharmacies and don't make any purchases there. The mothers' purchases considerably vary. Some mothers buy one pack a week, the others two packs every 2 weeks. Yet there are those who buy four packs once a month. Some mothers buy the entire stock of eight parcels once every 2 months. Now let's look at the retailers. The inventories are replenished when the final stock at the warehouse in a given week is lower than the demand forecast for the next week. If the final stock at the warehouse is bigger than forecast, the retailer refrains from buying. He generates a string of orders which takes the value of the order quantity Q or zero. Retailers stock up in warehouses. Every retailer generates a different string of orders buying a different batch of goods in another week. Now let's look at the producers. The product concerned is produced by only one producer. The producer gets the information on the demand based on the wholesaler's orders. The producer must rely on the demand forecasts because the timing of the orders received from the wholesalers is 1 week and the production cycle takes 2 weeks. Therefore, if the initial stock at the warehouse in a given week is larger than a certain B level, it is advisable to take for production the volume forecast for the next week. If the stock falls below the B level, the production order is the size of the forecast for the next period plus the difference between the B inventory levels and the stock at the warehouse. The production orders increase the warehouse stock in 2 weeks after their launch. This effect manifests itself in the fact that the demand of the end customers in the retail trade is constant, but the number of orders are becoming more irregular the farther we move backward in the supply chain. In this way, the orders at the lowest levels do not refer in any way to the consumer's orders. Let's talk now a little about the reasons for this phenomenon. The bullwhip effect is the result of an inefficient contact between the purchaser and the producer and other entities that are in the supply chain. This is for a simple reason. Because of frequent panic or uncertainty as to the receipt of the goods on time, the suppliers decide to increase orders despite the lack of market demand. Any other entity in the chain does exactly the same, receiving a signal of increased demand with no consumer analysis. The result? A dead call, which leads to distortion of information. The bullwhip effect occurs at this stage of supply chain, thus explaining the waves of sales, but also of other processes that lead to it, meaning the production, supply, etc. This effect is gaining momentum like a snowball, moving up the chain and causing the formation of excessive inventory. Now, let's answer the question, why we have to deal with this phenomenon? Well, the seller forming a larger order with the first entity in the chain sends a signal of increased demand, but in reality just wants to have a larger supply in case of price fluctuations or the extended lead time. Another entity receives the signal without checking it, also creating their own stocks. A similar situation is repeated every other entity up to the producer. As a result of erroneous information transfer, there starts to accumulate excessive inventory, creating the bullwhip effect. This frequently spontaneous and unrealistic increase in the demand results in the growth of orders in each successive link in the chain between the producer and the retailer. The more players there are in the supply chain, the larger the stocks, and thus the lack of stability in the activities. The cause of the bullwhip effect was divided into two categories, which result either from the operations or the behavior of the entities in the supply chain. The first category will include, among other things, misreading of the demand forecasts, the size of the order, price fluctuations, or even incorrect control systems, the lack of regulation of stocks up to undefined waiting times. And the behavior of the entities is associated with the fear due to the lack of inventory in the warehouse or a lack of trained personnel.